campus, meeting with students, sharing the gospel multiple times. Some people have gotten saved this week. Very cool. Actually, one of them was at church today. Two of them were at church this morning. Yeah, two of the people got saved, so that was really exciting. So what I want to do right now, though, is I'd like to kind of let you guys know what was going on. So we're going to have each of our missionaries share a story. And here's the reason. We're talking about faith today, and we've also got another video that ties into it in a completely different way, but it does tie in, and I'll tell you about that in a second. But here's the reality. Faith is how God operates. And our goal in this trip was to have faith that we would see God move here in the city in this church. I definitely think we have. So I know we have. So come on up. Woo!
Here you go.
Just put me on the spot. I'll just say that it's such a blessing and so rewarding to be here and to see brothers and sisters and have the fire to like know God, serve God more, and want to preach the gospel, share the gospel on campus. It's just such a blessing. And so I want to correct Chris one thing. It's not a fun trip. It's not a fun week. It's an exciting. It's so exciting to be here, and it's so exciting, to just went on campus and talk to those students. Of course, not everyone would really welcome us, but since Chris just told us right before the service. Each one of you needs to come out and share. So, what? Okay. Anyway, I just quickly want to share one of my many experiences for the past week here. Pretty much like we went to the university cafeteria last week, and I had an opportunity to talk to a junior year student in forestry. And he was there having his own lunch quietly, and I just like kind of heard him and said that, oh wow, do you mind if I can join you? But anyway, and after I kind of found out who, what status in school he was, and so I just identified me as a Christian, and I just came here to visit a church right across the street, want to invite him to visit our church. And then at that point, he told me that he's a Buddhist. He said, oh yeah, sure, I know. I grew up in, this is my hometown, right? I grew up in Taiwan, and I was not born as a Christian. So I totally understand why we believe, but at that point we all knew that they are not really Buddhists, they are just believing folk religion, which is they thought that they know something. So I just kind of share a little testimony and how God led me to know him through a group of Christian friends when I went to U.S. For my study. And so last year I came to the Lord through campus ministry, and then what the difference I see those Christians, the joy and peace, and they always so willing to give, to love. I was a new student there, new international student there. So anyway, and then I kind of led the conversation into the difference between Buddhism and Christianity. One is pretty much the work-based religion, and for Christianity is really faith-based. It's not because of what we have done, but because of our faith, and then God the face in the God, the face to receive Jesus, and Jesus transform internally within us, and then the good deeds or good, those doing good is just a reflection, a result of our faith. So, you know, he really listened very tentatively and showed his interest, but anyway, at the end of the conversation, he said that, oh, well, I gotta go, you know, I have a class, but I asked, okay, if I can pray for you, because during the conversation, I knew that he's facing an uncertainty of finding a job after graduation. So I just asked for permission if I can pray for him for his job hunting and for his future. And after the prayer, he seems very, I would say that he kind of like physically moved by, you know, by my sharing my testimony and my prayer, and he just repeatedly says that, thank you so much, thank you for sharing all this with me. So, you know, I had some church information and just encourage her, I mean, encourage him to visit us. That's a really, I trust God someday, I mean, very soon he will know Jesus.
Amen.
So, it's a best trip to me as well. And believe it or not, it's my first formal mission trip. So you guys can think about what a pressure I have when I step on the campus. I just want to share with you how God trained me in the past few years. When we walked in the campus, Chris, Kenny told us that we need to pray first, and then we can walk around the campus and pray and ask God's revelation. Show us which person we should talk with, and ask God to bring the correct people to us. And I say it's a training, it's not smooth, it's a very beginning. The first one we visit is a medical center. I thought, oh, those people got sick, they might need a prayer. They need God's love. So let's go. Then we walked into the medical center. You know, after we just share a few minutes, none of them would like to listen to us. Oh, we think it's kind of a setback. Then we continued to pray, and we split into two groups, two or three.
Not three.
Yeah, three groups. And I and Kenny start to walk on campus, and finally we find a person who sit by himself. And we start to talk with him, and the interviews us to him, and talk about what you do, what do I do. And then we start to get the conversation getting deeper and deeper, and we can got a chance to share the full gospel with him. And also invite him to come to our church on Thursday at lunchtime. You know what? Even Thursday it was raining, we did the show. So it gave me the confidence. Then in the next few days, we just practice our faith. Try to share the gospels, and God just gave us a favor. For example, I believe it was Thursday, yeah. Suppose Chris is going to give a presentation on campus, but Chris would be too busy, he scheduled four. in the altitude. So, Kenny and I went to the front, Kenny was speaking, I just helped somehow. After preaching, and shared a message, even the teacher for the next class was waiting for his turn. We probably used an extra 2 or 3 minutes. Then we walked out of the classroom. Then one student just followed us. He followed us, she followed us, we started to share, to talk about the love, the relationship. And another man student just joined us. And while we were sharing the gospel, another 2 students joined us. So we just continue to share the gospel, so to meet friends with them, we took the pictures, so we got their contact information, like a phone number and emails, their name, so we can continue keep in touch. While we were trying to walk out, to ask the students, hey, where do we go somewhere else? Then, asking for the direction, become another chance, and after we sit to another table. we just feel like it's getting more and more comfortable to share the gospel with people. And the students, no matter students, faculty, or visitors, they open their minds, they share everything with us. And the volunteer for some big event. No, it's not that one. It's kind of like a world college students Olympic, something like that. And we share the gospel with her, and she even shared her personal life with us. And then we went to I went to the gym with Receptor. We shared the gospel with her, and she just shared her life with us. She told us, I just want to do this. Then we asked, can we pray for you? She said, yes, please, we need it. We pray for her, and share the gospel with her. And I got a strong feeling if she was not that big, because she was interrupted by, she was receptor for the ping pong in the room in charge of that, the people continue to come in and off. But I just got a strong feeling, if we could kind of have extra, like 10 minutes, got better time, she would go. So I just feel like this church is in such a strategic location, and I felt like God just gave everyone in this church a calling to go to the campus. I got a training for the full 2 weeks. You guys got the next 9 weeks, months, years to go to training. I also found out that students here, their hearts were not as tough as a student from mainland China. We tried to share the gospel with them, they will say, no, I don't like it. I'm not interested in it. But here the students, they like to listen. They want to make friends with you. I just want to encourage everybody to use this wonderful opportunity to go to the campus to make friends with the students.
Hello everybody, good afternoon. Thank you everybody gave me the opportunity to share my experience here. Because my Chinese is better than my English, so I'm going to share my experience in Chinese and Kevin helped me to translate it.
This is my first overseas mission trip.
是在我人生的经历中的第一次。
哇，这是the many of the first, yeah, the first time in my life.
对，所以有很多东西我都不是很懂。
I really do not really know too much.
但是我的神给了我勇气，让我可以去面对这一切，然后也给了我很多的鼓励。
Yeah, and but God gave me courage, just made courage and encouragement to, you know, to go on this trip.
所以我现在来分享一些就是我们这次在校园里面的一些过程。
Yeah, I just share some stories I've been through in this trip.
昨天上午是台大的一个杜鹃花节。
So yesterday it was Azalea Festival. I just don't know that.
我和建设就一起到台大去看一下，有什么机会可以跟一些同学去分享。
Yeah, and Joshua and I went campus and to look for opportunity to share gospel with students.
其中有两个男生的同学给我留下非常深刻的印象。
Yeah, we met two male students which left a deep impression with me.
刚开始是他想向我们宣传一些他们的一些他们的一些理念。
Okay, yeah. In the beginning, it was actually start from like those two students really actually try to share their belief to us.
当他们跟我们分享的时候，我发现他们的这些理念跟我们的圣经里面是基本上是吻合的。
And after I listened to them, I actually thought that their belief pretty much quite in line with what the Bible has told us.
他们做了很多的这种工作是去比如说关心别人啊。
They have done a lot of caring.
他们就是强调当你付出的时候你会觉得有一种很快乐的这样子。
Yeah, they emphasize that when they did that or when they do that, they actually receive the happiness, the satisfaction, the feeling of satisfaction.
他们强调一个回报的理念，尤其是回报整个环境强调一些有机的概念呢。
Yeah, they kind of like they feel like they.Help to preserve the earth, and their good deeds can really provide them rewards, that kind of things.
他们很强调这样子给予的一个生命。
Yeah, they pretty emphasize in giving, giving out to others.
看得出来这两个学生是非常认真的思考他们这一生是要做什么事的人。
Yeah, I can tell they really are looking for what they should do in their life.
但是他们不知道他们要找的究竟是什么。
But obviously, they do not really know what they are looking for.
所以我跟建硕也跟他分享了一些关于福音的事啊。
So, and Joshua and I share the gospel with him.
并且告诉他们，他们现在所相信的东西正好跟我们的圣经是非常一致的。
And tell them that what they believe, what they are doing is actually quite in line with the Bible.
他们没有读过圣经。
They never read Bible before.
所以当他们听说后，看得出来他们真的是非常认真的在听。
Yeah, after they learn this fact, so I can tell they.Pay great attention in listening to our sharing.
他们也很好奇圣经。
They are curious as well.
因为看到这个地方，我真的就很感动。
And I was really touched.
这世上还是有很多人在寻求真理。
And there are still many people looking for the truth.
我们能做这个桥梁，帮助他们找到这个创造这个真理的神。
And we can be the bridge, bridge between the non-believer and the truth. You know, we can have the opportunity to be the bridge.
我觉得是很幸福的一件事。
It's a good thing. Yeah.
虽然整个过程当中也出现过很多拒绝我们的人。
Yeah. It was such a blessing. And even though we did have many people like they just reject us.
但是我觉得神还是给我们很多的鼓励，让我们看见这个世界上真的是有很多很多需要他的这些人。
Yeah, but I still feel like God really encouraged us and let us saw that there are so many lost and needed people.
这是我的分享，谢谢。
And this is my sharing. Thank you.
All right, so this is amazing. We hear all of these kinds of stories, all of these examples of faith, all of these times where people stepped out in faith, and at first, you know, it seemed like, oh, is God coming through? Is He really working? What's happening here?And so what I'd like to share with you now is it's a video that we showed, and this is just a small portion of it. It's a video we showed at the Kingdom Advance Day. The whole day, yes, that's right. And the reason why I want to show this is I want you to think of this. What is faith? We walk around every single day, and we just assume our bodies are going to work right.Things are going to function. That how we live, eat, move, and breathe, it's of course it works. Of course it works. Of course it works. And we take it as a certainty that it works. But I want to show you this. It's kind of funny. This video shows you inside of one cell, a single cell, the complexity and the just absolute mind-boggling detail of even that single cell. When you go to think about it,we really ought to be asking ourselves, oh my goodness, it's a step of faith to even believe that this all works properly. And so from that point, I'll go ahead and launch off into the sermon for the last 25 or so minutes, and we'll go ahead and talk about what really is faith. Because so often we just assume sometimes things are true, we have hope in other things, but we never really look to give glory to God who makes all things come to pass.You gotta find a specific version of it, because otherwise it's like 11 minutes long.
What is it called?
Inner life of the cell. Yeah. Let me see if it's pretty good position. Okay, we got it.If there's no video, I'll provide some narration. Okay, so what you're looking at right now is a bloodstream, and that's a white blood cell. It's moving alongside of the blood vessel. Now you're looking at the surface of the white blood vessel and what's known as a lipid raft. This is the internal side of the cell.And all the different pores that are arranged with a specific geometry. And these are the girders that sit at the internal structure of the cell that look much like steel girders in a building. And and this is how they assemble very quickly in their homes spontaneously. And these are how the girders are cut and rearranged. And these are how stronger girders or beams are formed, called microtubules, and how they're deconstructed. And that's a motor protein attached to a vesicle, literally walking alongside one of these steel girders, transporting things around the cell. This is how the cell actually goes and says, okay, here's what we're going to produce, new proteins, new building blocks. Think of this like a post office, only there's about a billion of these inside of your body all operating at the same time. Surface, and this is vesicle formation, which is a packaging. Think of that like being packaging. And so, what was once on the inside of the cell that was created is now put on the outside of the membrane. And sitting there is another lipid raft forming. That's going to be the housing point of all of these different proteins. And all of that is going outside of one single cell in your body. And now think about this, there are millions of these things. So your entire body is made of these cells. Here's the thing, we take it on faith that all of that is working correctly every day, every second. If any one part of that breaks down, you die. So here's the thing, I'll start with this, and I'm going to kind of jump around in the talk a little bit, so I'll just say I'm going to jump around here. Abraham was told when he was wondering if he was going to have a child, he was told, look up at the stars. And the thing is, in the starry night, way back then, you could see millions of stars in the sky. And he said, God told him, he said, look up at the stars. I'm going to make your descendants as numerous as the stars. So when Abraham, it took him 25 years before God finally brought the promise of that he was given faith into his life. But every night, he could look up at the stars and see. Now, it's funny, because we live in the city, and I live in the city too, and I don't see the stars that well. And so it actually struck me real strong one day when I was in Texas, out in the countryside. And all of a sudden, I went outside at night, and I mean, I've seen more stars than I've ever seen. It was like a painting in the sky. And I realized that God has given us some of these things. Look up the ability to look in the cell to see just how complicated we are and how beautifully and wonderfully he's made us. I mean, it really is shocking. You think about it. You see that little motor protein. I mean, that cell is like a little mini city. And there's millions of those going on. And we just take it for granted sometimes that these things just operate, that this all just works. I mean, it takes more, quote, faith to believe that that works than it does to that I'll get a check from the payroll office at the end of the week. I mean, my goodness, that thing, that's insane. And so I want to kind of have that frame sort of the talk today, even though we'll not take too long on it. You go to the next slide, about what is faith. Hebrews 11:1 says, faith is the reality of what is hoped for. It's the proof of what is not seen. You're breathing, you're walking around, you're moving, you're interacting, your muscles work. That's the proof of what's not seen. That there are little cities inside every single one of your cells that are carrying out reactions going on behind the scenes every moment of every day. Now the proof is right here in front of me, right? but you can't actually see any of that other stuff unless you get a microscope, okay? So I want you to start thinking about this in terms of God. How complex is that body? Insanely complex. And yet we're doing simple actions like moving a chair, holding a microphone. We're doing simple actions. But how much really is required to get that to happen? That level of complexity. So when we have faith in the promises of God, here's why we have faith. Because God is doing that level of stuff behind the scenes to make this all work out. And so we might not be able to see how God works, but when those promises come true, we'll know that He does. However, faith allows us to do two things. And it's different than hope, but I want to start with this one. Hope is the desire for something that is uncertain. I might hope I get a boat, or I might hope I get a big house, or I might hope that something happens, you know, I hope that I get finances. But those aren't things that are guaranteed. I might hope they happen, but it's uncertain. In fact, hope, if all we do is ever is hope for things, our lives are going to have a lot of fear. And the reason they're going to have a lot of fear is because we're putting our hope and our trust in things that are uncertain. And so there's a substantial fear that may not happen. But the reality is faith is assurance. Faith is a real substance. It's a real thing as much as love or justice or anything else. Those are very real things, even though we can't touch, taste, sense, and see them. They're very real. Faith is the same. When you have faith from God, it is an assurance or certainty that something is true. It's a certainty. Next one. Now, how the question is this, though. How do we move from a place of hope, where we're just hoping things happen, to a place of faith where we have assurance? Well, the first aspect of this is maintaining an attitude of expectancy. See, in Hebrews, it talks about how Abraham, even over the course of 25 years, expected God's promise to come through. He expected it. He may have wavered at times or things, but for the most part, he maintained a steady expectancy. He believed this was going to come true. Faith literally is a spiritual change in the heart. It's not, I'm going to get enough faith, I'm going to build enough faith and convince myself that something's true. It's not about convincing yourself. It's a real heart change from God that confirms the truth of what He has said. Okay? One believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness. What does that mean? It means you can be transformed, not by your own actions. But when God gives you the gift of faith, and you hold on to that, and you act on it, you literally become transformed. How do we become sanctified? Not by our own power, not by deciding to do the right thing over and over and over again. That's not how it happens. It's only by the fact that we have faith in God, in His promise, that by His Spirit, we become renewed. We become whole again. We have our hearts clean and transformed. Next one. Hope can be placed in anyone or anything. I can place hope in anything, literally. I can place hope in my phone that I'll be able to connect to somebody. But there's only one real object of faith, and that is God. Believe in God, believe also in me. You can't just have faith for anything or faith in anything. You can have hope for anything. You can have hope in anything. But faith, no. There's only one, not a better word, thing, person, if you will, that you can have faith in, and that's God. That's it. You can't have faith in anything else. And here's the interesting thing. What do you have faith in? Him, and that His promises, that which He has said and spoken, will come true. So you can't just have faith for some random thing. You've got to have faith for for something God has said. Next one. For example, anyone who believes has eternal life. Now, who gets eternal life? Some who believe, a few who believe. You may get eternal life if you believe. No. It is anyone. This is a promise of God. Therefore, even though your body may still decay and die, right? It happens every day. We're called to have faith that we have eternal life here in the present. This is the kingdom of God. How do we call the kingdom of God on this earth? Through faith. We proclaim that the kingdom is here. That's the only way to do it. We can't hope someone gets healed or hope someone gets forgiven. No, we have to say it in faith that this is true. Not that it's even going to happen. See, here's the thing. That word has, that's present tense. You have eternal life now. It's not all far off in the future, although there's the full blessing is in the future. We do receive some of the blessing now. We receive a relationship with God. We receive the possibility of being healed from sin. We receive forgiveness of sins. We receive overcoming the enemy because we have the promise of eternal life. And when we walk that out in faith, not hoping, not saying, well, maybe I'll get healed, maybe I'll defeat the enemy, maybe. No. If that's where you feel, you got to stop yourself right there and say, God, give me real faith. Because he has to do it. He has to plant that faith in your heart. There's no other way to get it. Because faith is certainty. It's assurance. And we can't, as limited, finite beings, we can't have that kind of assurance based on our own human knowledge. It's incomplete. Our own human knowledge is incomplete. The only way we get that level of assurance is from the one who knows all things. And apparently, he is so working things out in this world that he can assure us that we have eternal life if we believe. This is the beauty of faith. Whereas hope often disappoints, disillusions, and causes despair because it doesn't satisfy. I hope this happens and it doesn't. Well, what does that mean? I'm just upset and disillusioned and disappointed that it happened. Faith fulfills. Faith withstands death. Faith reflects the glory of God. We want to talk about glorifying God. Have faith in God and he will be glorified. See, this is the thing. Maybe everything we wanted to happen didn't happen this week in our evangelism. A lot of people turned us down. But we had faith in God through this whole thing. There were times when we could just doubt their random points. But overall, we had faith in God through the whole thing. And he was glorified. And things did happen. Amazing stories happened because we had faith in God. Not because we're great, not because we're great evangelists. Not because we have some special thing that makes us all, no. Half the team, it's our first missions trip. Okay? We just said we have faith to see something happen. We shared in the earlier service. I love the movie The Incredibles. Have you guys seen this?
Yes.
Okay. My favorite part of the whole movie is that kid on the tricycle in the driveway. Why? Because that kid sat there all day long. He sat there all day long. And the dad, he knew there were superheroes in this house. And the dad comes up and is like, why are you sitting here? And the kid's like, I just want to see something awesome happen. And the kid sat there all day for 12 hours. And then I think at one point, the guy lifts the car and puts it down. And the kid's like, you know, it's sort of like that. Well, guess what? If the kid walked away an hour in, he wouldn't have seen it. If he walked away 2 hours, then he wouldn't have seen it. If he walked away 4 hours, then he wouldn't have seen it. But he didn't care. If Abraham walked away and a year in,
he wouldn't have received the blessing. If he walked away 5 years in, he wouldn't have received the blessing. But he stayed in it for the long run. Sometimes it happens in a minute. You have faith and boom, it just happens. Sometimes a day, sometimes a week, sometimes a year. But the point is we're called to have faith in God. And when we do, I'm dead serious, when we do and it's lined up with his promises, we won't be disappointed. Ever. You will never be disappointed in God. Because he's always truthful, isn't he? He's always faithful. How often is God not faithful? Never. He's always faithful. Even when we're faithless, he's faithful. This is the blessing and beauty of who God is. He doesn't change. And so when we talk about faith, what's he going to say? And that's what he's going to say. Abraham didn't waver in unbelief at God's promise, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God because he was fully convinced, not partially, fully, that's only a God-level convincing, that what he had promised he was also able to perform. See, here's the thing. I might not see healing immediately in someone's life, but I'm fully convinced that my God is able to perform it and wants to. And that somehow behind the scenes, he's working in a person's life to see it happen. That goes for anything. Defeat of the enemy, forgiveness of sins, it doesn't matter. Guess what? Salvations don't take place because we're good preachers. Now, we need to be good preachers in a sense, make sure we get the full gospel out there so people know what they believe. But it's not our eloquence or how well we speak. You know what it is? I have faith that God is working in this person's life to bring them to repentance and forgiveness of sins. That's it. That is it. Next one. It's a beautiful expression of God's glory when he's able to bless his children with the promises he has in store for them. But it's important to remember two things. And this is what I'll close on today. Thing number one, Dr. Seuss style. Thing two. All of the things we have faith for ultimately are God-centered and magnify his truth and his power. They're not us-centered. This is how you avoid prosperity theology. This is how you avoid the prosperity gospel. They tell you have faith for what? Anything. Mm-mm. You only have faith for the things that were promised of God. And those things you have faith for all the time. You walk that thing out. Number two, all of the promises of God are directly related to and from the Word of God. See, here's the thing. There's the Spirit and there's truth. If you get the Spirit and you don't really do truth, here's the reality. God's going to pour out a Spirit, right? It didn't say on those who know the Bible real well. The Spirit just gets poured out. And so suddenly people can start believing for random things and having horrible theology. People have the truth, and they don't have the Spirit, and they're like, oh, I know everything, but guess what? They have no faith. So they don't see things happen, because they know the promises, but they don't believe that they're going to come about. When you get the Spirit and the truth together, you get the promises of God lined up with the faith of God, and you see God move. It's vital that we understand that, because that's how we stay balanced. That's how we stay moving forward. And this week, we definitely saw that. We had salvations happen this week. We had all sorts of cool things. We had miracles happen this week. We had awesome prophetic ministry this week. I mean, real fast. I know we got a break here, but I think it was Annie and I went out on Monday, and I just said, you know, we're just going to go walk around. We got to these two people in this Adam Atomic building. I think it was a big hall, something like that. And I just went up and talked to them, and they spilled their guts. Right in front of us, the one girl admitted, she's like, I'm afraid of death. I go to bed and I'm freaked out every night that I'm going to die. And I looked her right in the face and I said, there is only one thing that's going to free you from death, and that's Jesus. And I basically told her, I was like, look, God can defeat the fear of death in your life. And she wasn't ready to accept it, but I was like, I'm preaching to you right now. And we got the contact information. So that's the thing, we've got all these people, there's so many people out there.
that are desperate and hungry for something certain in their lives. And if we don't walk in faith, they won't see that certainty living out in us. And so the challenge for today is walk in that certainty. Walk in that faith. Take the promises of God and assert them over your life. It's not that you're going to have a perfect life. It's not that nothing bad's ever going to happen. But the promises of God, what are some of them? Well, that you'll be holy. That your sanctification. That you'll have eternal life. That you can actually receive healing. These are all promises of God. And He said, by His wounds we are healed. That's not just a select few. That's everybody. Okay, so that's all I want to share today. Just a little brief thing on faith. Thank you very much for the team sharing. Thank you guys for having us. This is our, we have one more event on Tuesday, but this is sort of the last big thrust of the missions trip, so I think people are kind of dispersing from here. So I just want to say blessings to you guys, and maybe we'll pray a little bit. I'll go ahead and pray real quick for an impartation of faith. Is that okay?
Yes.
Cool. All right, and if the missions team can come up, if people want individual prayer, they'll be up here. You can go up and receive individual prayer, but I'm going to walk around right now and just pray for everybody as we close today. Lord, I thank you so much right now, God, and I just pray your faith right now upon every single person here, God. I'm asking for your faith and impartation right now in the name of Jesus by the Spirit. Faith according to your word. God, we just ask right now for faith according to your word. Lord, I just ask, God, what type of faith do you want to reveal today? I feel like there is. For some people in here, there is a legitimate fear of death in the sense that they really feel it. And so, God, I would like you, if you guys want to, if you have had a fear of death or a fear of sickness or fear of dying or something like that, go ahead, just raise your hand and say, God, I claim in faith eternal life and the defeat of fear in my life. Lord, we just praise your name right now. I also just feel like as well for healing, if there is somebody who needs healing right now in the name of Jesus, God is saying, now, at this moment, stand in faith. Literally, you said, by my wounds, you're healed. There's no reason not to take a stand in faith. So if you raise your hand right now for that, go right ahead and just say, I accept Jesus' healing for my body or on behalf of someone else as well. God's healing people, I believe it. In the name of Jesus, we thank you. Also, if there is someone in your life that you are feeling like needs the salvation of Jesus, God is also saying, trust in me, have faith in me, and I will reach this person, because ultimately every salvation is a miracle. So if there's a person in your life right now who you'd like to see come to Christ, go ahead and throw your hand up and say, God, I believe right now that they can get you in their hearts, that you can breach the hardness of their hearts and come through. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.